Let's get educated. That's why we're here, to bring you the stories impacting K-12 classrooms and college campuses. It's time for a little education.
Well, hello everyone. I am Katie Petrick, and as always, I am joined by the very happy, it's still January, David Fiorazo. He's still excited that it's the new year.
Actually, it's past the halfway mark of January, so maybe I say Happy New Year a little less often now.
Maybe three times an episode instead of four. All right, well, what happened today, this morning, for you on Worldview Matters?
Pastor Matt Truella on worldviewmatters.tv. His website is defytyrants.com, and we talked about a very important doctrine called the doctrine of the lesser magistrate, about holding our representatives accountable and having them disobey orders from above, government-wise, if those orders are not good for the people or if they are unbiblical. They have a responsibility. So anyway, great conversation with Pastor Matt Truella. Subscribe and get one weekly email on a Friday, worldviewmatters.tv.
All right, excellent. Well, we're going to talk today about a winning university that is also losing, very much so, because of what we're actually going to talk about. And what am I talking about, David? Of course, I'm talking about the University of Michigan, where they've become so brainwashed at this point into thinking that everyone is racist, that their salaries for those DEI or DIE staff, if you put all that money together, you could actually, instead of paying these people, use that money for almost 1,800 students to be given full tuition rides.
Oh my goodness.
But no. Let's give them all that money to the DIE, as I'm going to, on this show, we should make it a point now to call it DIE.
Yeah.
Because that's what it's doing to the nation, DIE.
So full disclosure, I was born in Michigan, grew up in Michigan. I'm a University of Michigan football fan. So I was thrilled that they won the national championship. And the players, most of them, glorified God and said how blessed they were that they were able to do so. But the administrators and the college itself, and it's not the only university, but it's a big one, and these numbers are staggering. University of Michigan has more than 500 jobs dedicated to diversity, equity, and inclusion, DEI. And according to this analysis, the college fix, payroll costs exceed $30 million. So the U of M is growing this program. And my question, Katie, one of my questions is DEI another manufactured crisis?
Absolutely.
Is this something that, I think it was, who was it? I'll remember her name later, but someone that wrote an op-ed on this in the New York Times, someone, a conservative, and she said—
In the New York Times, conservative?
That narrows
it down. Once upon a time was Reuben, but not anymore.
On occasion, they let them speak. But they said that this is a problem that didn't exist, so they have to create one and create solutions for it, and look what they're doing. I mean, let's just look at just some of the numbers here. First of all, payroll costs, $23.2 million for salaries, $7.4 million for benefits. And Katie, you can go ahead.
Have 241 paid staff members whose main duties are the DEI programming and services.
Wow.
Okay, 241 people who are like, my job, if you're like at a cocktail party, hey, what do you do? Well, I do DIE. DEI. I do all the things for diversity, inclusivity, and basically exclusivity instead of equity.
It's really
is what they really do.
Yep.
And that's like, that's what they do. They say they do at the University of Michigan. In addition, 76 faculty or staff members will work part-time as DEI unit leads, advancing diversity efforts. What kind of nonsense? This isn't just another thing like, we're starting a committee. Who wants to be on it? Except it's the entire university, and not even just at University of Michigan, the entire university system across the nation.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, we're starting this thing called DEI. Who wants to be on it? If you're not on it, you're a racist.
Yeah,
so
I mean, the Ivy Leagues, and we've talked about Claudine Gay and Harvard and the Ivy Leagues, but I want to mention Ohio State University. They doubled its DEI staff in 5 years, and the payroll costs almost tripled at Ohio State, according to another analysis. But we're talking about Michigan. We actually have a video of a University of Michigan DEI summit promo. Go ahead, we'll come back and talk about it.
Please join us throughout October for the University of Michigan's 2023 DEI Summit activities.
Our theme for this year's summit is truth-telling, the kinship of critical race theory and hip-hop.
Join the conversation as we explore the transformative power of storytelling, a fundamental element in hip-hop and critical race theory.
Both movements have significantly sculpted our current mainstream culture, and it's time to talk about it as a community.
We'll get started with the community assembly on Monday, October 9th at the Power Center for Performing Arts.
You don't want to miss out on our dynamic list of panelists,
including hip-hop artist and social justice activist
David Banner,
Grammy-nominated hip-hop artist Rhapsody,
and author and distinguished professor Dr. Andre Douglas Pond Cummings.
You know, there's so much.
I'm busy.
So much to point out there, but I will say I LOL'd, and you got the kinship of CRT and hip hop, and you're going, okay, this is. But the problem is, it's not just one university. Now we're picking on the U of M because they're putting astounding amounts of money behind this ideology that is not fair. It might be diverse, but if you consider diversity, you all look different, but you think the same.
Yeah.
Then that's DEI, right?
Yeah.
You look, there's different. Like they had, a black person and a white person. They're all talking about this CRT and hip hop. So they look very different, come from very different backgrounds, but they're aligned with the unbiblical worldview of. And they admitted one of the speakers is a social justice activist.
Well, that's
so they're admitting that at least.
That's the street cred these days, didn't you know, David? If you want to be a hip hop artist, whatever. Doesn't matter, you know, where you grew up and how you grew up. It's just that you're a social justice advocate or activist. Not even an advocate, a full-on activist.
Katie,
then you got your street cred for you.
How many times on this program have we said what the K through 12 education system is doing is making disciples of the left.
Yep.
And they are producing political activists and social justice activists. They're just sending these out into the world after they graduate from high school. They end up in colleges and then they end up on videos like that, you know, supporting CRT and hip hop and DEI videos.
Well, and it used to be that in college, you know, you would be exposed to new ideas. You know, you're leaving your small town, going out into the big world. You're now a little fish, big pond, and you might see some things that you've never seen before. But now they get it at the K-12 level all the way through, and then they get it at the college level. So that's why everyone thinks the same, is because they're getting exposed to the exact same thing all the way through. We need to really flip the script on all of this and start to think about how this is going to impact our lives. Our lives as all of us get older, and these people who are younger than us now are going to be the doctors and the lawyers and supposed to be taking care of all of us. Good luck to us. They're going to be asking what your pronoun is before they can touch you to give you a haircut. And if you think that's a false thing, I just did a report on it. So yes, can I touch you? Yes, I hired you here to give me a haircut. Yeah. Yes, you can touch my hair. Look at me. And then they asked about their pronouns. That's the focus. Now imagine that taken to the health extreme and taken to, you know, who's going to represent you in a court of law. Good luck. Anyway, we got one more thing about the millions of dollars that are being wasted. And, you know, we want to talk about how money is being wasted. So we're going to talk about that total annual payroll that University of Michigan's full-time DEI staff has estimated. It's about $30.68 million. Now, really, it's only $23 million for salaries, but then, you know, you do, because we give them benefits, these, you know, employee fringe benefits, because we're holding the man down or something. So now that they get their fringe benefits added on, we're talking about $30.68 million. And if you took that money and been like, you know what, how much would that, how many students would that pay for? Yeah, that would be 1,781 undergrad students instead. So pay these people their $30 million or let, you know, actual students, nearly 2,000 of them, or 1,800, I guess, get an education. Which one should we do?
So we also want to point out a conclusion that was done. Student well-being declined on campus And so the DEI initiatives apparently aren't working. And the campus climate surveys conducted up until 2021 found that University of Michigan students became less happy and probably more divisive. And since the beginning of DEI 1.0 on nearly every metric. So it's not a success according to what I guess it's supposed to do, helping the students on campus. But anyway, moving on, thanks to a conservative activist and Elon Musk, the Ivy League, University of Princeton, is forced to remove their DEI staff page. But wait till you see how the woke are now claiming they're victims. That's next.
So the University of Michigan is literally dumping money into useless projects, but
they're not alone.
They're correct. But we have other universities who maybe, fingers crossed here, boomeranging back to reality after they get caught for being ridiculous. So Princeton, Ivy League, I'm so special at Princeton.
Yes.
Removed their DIE staff page from their website because Christopher Rufo, shout out.
Yep.
Christopher Rufo, amazing. He criticized that staff page on the Twitter. Here's what he said. He tweeted out, "This is Princeton University's DEI office. Pronouns include they, them, she, they, he, and my favorite, no pronouns." Imagine this department governing what you can think, say, and do. And again, this goes back to what I was saying in the last story. Think that all these people one day are going to be in charge of this country and responsible for, you know, saving your life, maybe, if something, God forbid, happens to you. But don't worry, it won't be these specific people like LaTanya Buck Jones, she, her, hers, Eric Ann Glaro, they, them, Erica Avalos, she, her, Ella. What? How does Ella? Ella. Anyway, but here is our favorite, Jess Norman. No pronouns. Instead, please use my name. I actually think Jess is being the most reasonable. I'd be like, my name. Just use my name, people. You are too dumb. But I don't know that Jess is thinking in the same vein of thought as I am. So the best part of this, maybe, is the fact that Elon Musk responded to Christopher Rufo's tweet with an exclamation point. That's all he said. That's all it takes. One little exclamation point for now the whole world to have seen this, because Elon Musk has how many millions of followers, obviously. And so Rufo responded to Elon Musk's exclamation point by saying, "Imagine what the pronoun people want to do to X," so Twitter, which Elon Musk owns, "and then imagine the same thing for our entire society."
Yep.
So what happened then is, because Elon Musk retweeted this and commented, the school took down the page. And now they are offering support to their to their DIE people.
They're giving them a safe space?
Safe space.
Yeah.
A commitment to DEI after information about several employees was shared. So,
Oh my goodness. These people are either
the vice provost,
sheltered, entitled.
Oh yeah, it's we're going to keep going on
okay,
this.
Okay.
The vice provost for institutional equity and diversity. Again, one of those $30 million jobs over at Michigan. They have one at Princeton called the Vice Provost for Institutional Equity and Diversity. Michelle Minter told the school newspaper, the Daily Princetonian, that "we have been in touch with those affected by this incident to offer support. We are considering additional steps to protect DEI practitioners who are unfairly being targeted for the excellent work that they do." Here's my question, Michelle. Do they all identify as they? That he, she, Ella does.
Well, Ella, I think, identifies as Cinder.
Ella.
Cinderella.
Maybe that's what it stands for. I'm not even sure.
She identifies as a, I'm really holding back.
Well, keep holding back because I'm going to talk about Texas University.
Keep going.
That also is replacing their DEI office because of the statewide ban that's happening But they may not be really boomeranging back to reality because they are going to replace it with an Office of Campus and Community Belonging. So now, because like Texas actually put it in writing via Senate Bill 17, which bans DEI initiatives.
They'll just call it something else.
They are calling it something else. Yeah. So at the University of Texas at San Antonio, they closed their DEI office. But again, they're calling it the... Office of Campus and Community Belonging. And according to the university president, Taylor Egme, sent to students, faculty, and staff, it says, I'm writing today to share a new path ahead that upholds the law. So Senate Bill 17. While still advancing our core values to ensuring a welcoming, collaborative, and supportive environment where all faculty, staff, and students can thrive. You know, we just celebrated MLK Day. What did MLK want? What's that famous line he says? He imagines, you know, a place where...
Well, I know he had a dream.
He has this dream and something about color and
people
how it doesn't judge matter.
By the content of their character and not the color of their skin. How about a society like that?
Yeah, maybe he can be part of the Office of Campus and Community Belonging then. Maybe. What do you all think?
Yeah.
All right. Well, still to come. Big shocker out here. Despite widespread DEI training, college anti-Semitism has surged by more than 1,000%. So let's talk about it.
Today's show is sponsored by our friends at MyPillow. Save up to 66% on pristine quality bedding, towels, slippers, signature pillows, and much more when you use the code EDUCATED. That's EDUCATED, EDUCATED. Support this show and a great American company.
Well, with all of that DIEDI, you'd think we'd be so inclusive, David. We're kumbaya, so inclusive as a nation. No. So, you know, when you talk about DIE, it's talking about the minority groups, right, David? Those who have been persecuted, if you
will. They're victims, yes.
So, if we look historically, you would think that Jewish people, people of the Jewish religion, people who are from Israel, you would think.
One would think.
These people would be included in this DIEDI. Yes?
That's an interesting point.
No! That's not how it goes here. According to the Anti-Defamation League, they reported anti-Semitic incidents on college campuses rose just, 1,000%.
Wait a minute. Is that a typo? Is that one or two too many zeros in there? Is that really 1,000?
Well, I mean, when we're talking, if you want to talk stereotypes and numbers and dollar signs and Jewish people, we can. But we won't. We're talking 1,000% here in 2 months' time. Just in 2 months' time, it rose by 1,000%, going October 7th. What happened October 7th, 2023? Anything?
Demonic and brutal and horrific attacks by Hamas on Israel.
I was going to let them, the viewers,
just let's
go.
Be reminded,
good point.
Because
solid point. Solid
many
point.
People have forgotten history. We are now being doomed to repeat it, and here we go.
And it is interesting that they, that's coincidental, I guess, to December 7th. Which historically is an important date, too. Anyone want to guess what that happened, December 7th?
Pearl Harbor.
Shh.
Oh, sorry.
You gave it away again. Stop it.
Sorry.
So anyway, in that 2 months' time, they looked at that time period, those 2 months, to a year prior. And so that's where they got that 1,000% jump. So between October 7th and December 7th of this past year, ADL... So the Anti-Defamation League recorded 400 anti-Semitic incidents on college campuses. Same time period last year was 33. 400? 33. 33, still bad. But 400 way
so
up
that's,
here?
That's
all across the nation. It's not even isolated to like one place. It is
we're talking
across
2 months
the nation.
In,
you know what?
In
everyone
months.
Go to North and South Dakota. You're that's
yeah,
the
look
only
at that.
Good
Those
place.
Are the only states that don't no, have any anti-Semitism.
In a quick look, even Hawaii has one and Alaska.
Yeah.
Montana.
Wow.
Even Utah, but a lot over in the East Coast and California. Wow,
look at
I am shocked.
Yeah, look at the left
shocked,
coast and
no
the
one.
East Coast. Look at that. Wow.
Yeah, horrific. Now, apparently, The incidents at college campuses did represent nearly 20% of the total number of anti-Semitic incidents that have been documented by ADL, which was 2,031. So if you're looking at the whole year, you're talking about over 2,000 incidents. This is ridiculous. Like, why is this happening? The figure does indicate that there were almost 34 anti-Semitic incidents per day in the U.S. during that two-month period.
Wow.
So these kids on these college campuses, and it may not be the kids. It may be, they're technically adults. Well, everyone there is supposed to be an adult.
They're brainwashed.
Between the
or
professors, between the students, between administration, between I don't even know what. There could be outside protesting groups coming in. Could be all of it combined. 34 every day during those 2 months. Yeah. It's the highest rate ever recorded in 2 months since they began tracking this back in 1979. So of the total anti-Semitic occurrences, 40 of them were physical assaults. 337 were vandalism because we're a bunch of chicken bleeps. We can't just face those we'd like to accuse of things, but we have to go graffiti something and then run away in the darkness.
Yeah.
And 749 incidents were verbal or written harassment of Jews because all we do is hide behind our computers or we leave notes on doors for people. That's what we do. The ADL did report that at least 1,411, which is around 70%, of the incidents could clearly be linked to the ongoing war between Israel and Hamas. Huh. It's almost as if the way you report things in what is being told to these students especially has an impact on the way they think and the way they react to things. David?
Well, can I just say how this ends over at the Campus Reform, connecting the last couple stories we've talked about. 56% of surveyed students admitted to undergoing some form of DEI, diversity, equity, and inclusion training, but only 18% received instruction on anti-Jewish hate. So apparently it's not part of the overall DEI.
See, and if we would get rid of that entire 56%, so none of them would get this training, I think everyone would be better. That 18% of not receiving the anti-Jewish hate would actually probably be 100% would get something because they would learn true history in their history classes. And maybe the world would be a better place, but we'll go on from there because we have to talk about something very important, David. You know the age-old tale of my dog ate my homework, right? Yes? Mm-hmm. Now, there's one couple who have a dog that decided to snack on something much more costly. Cha-ching, cha-ching. So get ready to meet Cecil. Stay with us.
If you have a smartphone, tablet, Roku, or Apple TV, consider downloading the Freedom Project Media app. It's 100% free and includes all of our weekly shows, plus lecture series, archive programs, and award-winning animated videos for families like The Presidential Minute, Battles of America, and Heroes of the West. Don't rely on the social media giants to keep you informed. Simply download the Freedom Project Media app from your app store and allow notifications. And we'll let you know when a new video is ready.
All right, so I actually in school once, I don't remember what grade, I was probably in eighth grade or ninth grade. I actually came home because I lived down the street from the school and I could go home and, let the dog out, and my dad would come home for lunch. And I actually used the excuse that for being late that I had to feed my dog.
Very nice.
For being late. But I never used the he ate my homework.
Oh, okay.
But in this story, there was a dog that ate cash. $4,000 in cash. And you're going, wait a minute. What was $4,000 in cash doing laying around where the dog could reach it and get a hold of it? Apparently, there were a lot of $100 bills and $50 bills there. You can see in the picture. But it's Cecil. Cecil's the dog. And this was in Pittsburgh. The dog had never done anything like this, apparently, until he ate $4,000. And then, let's watch the video. We'll come back and we'll talk about it.
Good boy.
This Pennsylvania couple says their dog, Cecil, never gets into trouble.
Yeah, he's normally
pretty much like this. Just kind of like really likes to intensely stare at people.
But that all changed when Carrie and Clayton Law found that their 7-year-old pup had hopped onto the counter and ate a very expensive snack, $4,000 in cash.
Cecil's just standing there on top of this pile of, you know, just mutilated money, torn bite marks, envelopes completely missing, and I was just kind of in shock.
The Laws had taken the money out of the bank that day for a home improvement project, setting it on the counter and walking away momentarily. That's when Cecil got his paws on the paper and devoured the bills.
I'm just like following him, you know, each time he goes out and see if he goes, and he went, and lo and behold, there was definitely like visible money in there. So I was like, hey, this, I'm just going to pick it up, grab it, and then we'll kind of sift through it.
Detailing their journey in this now viral video, the Laws were able to piece together the shredded cash, salvaging $3,500.
I mean, that's not so bad.
There's so many angles to this story. I mean, the dog jumped up on the counter. He's never done anything. He looked like a very mild-mannered dog. Never done anything like that before. What would attract a dog to the scent of cash?
I mean, people are attracted to the scent of cash.
No, but is there some sort of chemical that has something to do with food or something that the dog would want to eat? That's one thing. The other thing is, once the dog eats it and it's in his system and he's going to poop it out, all right, it's gone. I'm done. I'll take that as a loss. But they're going through the pieces and they're washing them off. And I want to finish by saying the bank was very understanding, they said, fully aware of the situation, and they were really nice about it. But apparently they've resurrected a total of $3,550 out of $4,000. Maybe they'll get the rest, but maybe not. Some of those pieces were really small. So what were they doing? They were in the house, and the dog's chewing up this money, eating and chewing up the money.
Well, it took, they went down the hallway for a second. Trust me, I have kids. Things happen in like lickety split.
But that,
lickety split, David. You don't even understand.
That's a lot of bills and one dog. And
they got $3,550 back. That means they got maybe $400 and a $50 left to get back. Let's see. Unless it's all 50s, in which that might take a little longer to get out.
Jeez.
Well, we'll see. It's a fun one.
Doggone
either way.
Doggone it.
Doggone it. That's right. And doggone it, don't you out there forget that you can catch Educated on the go by subscribing on your favorite audio podcast platform. And don't forget to download the Freedom Project Media app. Now, for David and myself, thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. And thank you for supporting this show. Until next time, stay educated.